الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. وإن our third lecture or the third lesson in the introduction to Aqeedah. Today, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to be speaking about bi'aunillahi wa tawfiqih. We're going to be speaking about asma, names, wa alqab, nicknames, for who ahlul aqeedah as-sahihah. The people whose aqeedah is sound, what names do they have? And what names were given to them? So I'm going to mention the name, and I'm also going to mention the evidence for those names. Where did they come from? Who gave them that name? That is what we're going to do, inshallah ta'ala, today. So أسماء وألقاب أهل العقيدة الصحيحة. أسماء and ألقاب, in English it would be names and nicknames, for who أهل العقيدة الصحيحة, the people who have sound creed, the عقيدة الصحيح, correct عقيدة, they have names. But their names is taken from the نصوص الوحيين, it's taken from the Quran and the Sunnah. They don't just give themselves a name. So inshallah ta'ala, we're going to go through those names. First one, inshallah ta'ala. First name that they have is that they're called Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah. They are called Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah. As you can see from the name, the name is compounded of two words. The word as-sunnah and al-jama'ah. Ahl means people, family. Your ahl is your family. Here what it means is the people of the, number one, sunnah, and number two, wal-jama'ah. So we're going to expand on that bi-ithnillahi al-kareem. The word sunnah, we've already spoken about it in great details, correct? So what does sunnah here mean? What did we say sunnah meant according to the people of aqeedah? ما يقابل البدعة. We said that sunnah according to the scholars of aqeedah, it means ما يقابل البدعة. What does yuqabilu mean? That which is in direct opposition towards innovation. So they are the people of the sunnah. They are in direct opposition towards innovation. They do not innovate. The innovation is اعتقادي or it's عملي. Neither of those two is present in them. اعتقادي means a innovation which is a belief. You believe something in your heart. This is the belief of the Khawarij, who believe if a Muslim does a major sin, that he's a disbeliever. If he drinks khamar, they believe he's a kafir. So they believe major sins makes a person a disbeliever. This is the i'tiqad, which is bid'ah, Is that crystal clear? The second one is amali. It's action. It's not a belief. But it's a what? It's a i'tiqad, which is amali. It's action based. This is also not present with Ahlus Sunnah. Neither of those two are found in them. They believe that we only do what we find in the Quran and the Sunnah. Now, here you have to ponder here, brothers. And I want you to focus here. The reason why they are called Ahlus Sunnah and not Ahlul Quran is because no one denied the Quran. Something that was already agreed upon. Everyone admitted and accepted the Quran. This is a fa'ida latifa. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah and Ibn al-Qayyim in his kitab Sawa'iq al-Mursala, they pointed this out. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, he mentions it. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah mentions it in his kitab Mujmal al-I'tiqad Ahli Sunnah wal Jama'ah. He mentioned his kitab Bayan al-Dalil fi Butlan al-Tahlil. And he mentions it in his Majmu' al-Fatawa. Ibn al-Qayyim, he mentions it in Sawa'iq al-Mursala. And he also mentions it in his kitab Ighathatul Lahfan. But don't busy yourself with the references. Just know that the term Ahlus Sunnah was given to them because the mawtinun niza', the point of argumentation and conflict between the early generation was due to the Sunnah. Okay? How was there a conflict between them and the Sunnah? They were rejecting the Sunnah in two ways. There was a rafd mutlaq. What does rafd mutlaq mean? Complete and total rejection of the Sunnah. And we have a group like that today. What do they say? They call themselves the Quraniyun, they call themselves. They're not Quraniyun haqiqatan. Because if you're a Qurani and you follow the Quran tells you to follow the what? Sunnah. So they are not Quraniyun. Are we all together? This is rafd mutlaq, total rejection of the Sunnah. And say the Sunnah we don't accept. We only accept the Quran. And Allah in many places in the Quran, He commands us to what? Follow the Sunnah. فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. In another ayah, Allah says, وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَن يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. In another place, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, إِنَّمَا كَانَ قَوْلَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذَا دُعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ لِيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَهُمْ أَن يَقُولُوا سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. In another ayah, Allah says, فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَن تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةٌ أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. In another ayah, Allah says, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. All of those ayats, what do they show? And much more. That we have to follow the Sunnah. So they are not Quraniyun. Because they are not following the Quran. The Quran is commanding them to do what? To follow the Sunnah. So that's the first type. Rafd mutlaq. Complete and total rejection of the Sunnah. The second one is, it's called rafd, which is juz'i. Rafd juz'i means we accept the Sunnah, but we only accept that which is multitude narration, mutawatir. If it's singular narration or few in number, we don't accept that. That's a type of rejection of the Sunnah. But it's a rafd juz'i. Are we all together? The second type is dividing the Sunnah into two by calling it Sunnah which is mutawatir. Mutawatir means what? Large in number, multitude narration. They say we will accept that one. Okay. But what about if it's not large in number? What about if it reaches us in few number? They say we don't accept that. In what? In aqidah. This is a type of rejection. But this type of rejection is a rafd juz'i. It's a what? It's a partial rejection. It's a what? Partial rejection. the Ahlul Sunnah, they do neither of those two. Are we all together, brothers? They accept the Sunnah in totality. Does that make sense? So that's why they are called Ahlul Sunnah. Wal Jama'ah. The second part of their name is that they are called Al-Jama'ah. What does the word Al-Jama'ah mean? Al-Jama'ah, it means Al-Adadu Al-Kathir. Al-Jama'ah means once it's a group of people. It's a group. Al-Jama'ah means group. That is what it means in the language. It's any individuals or any people who unite, they come together on a matter. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah says, whether it's good or bad, it doesn't matter. It's anyone who come together in the Arabic language, if they come together and they unite and they are now called a jama'ah, a group. It doesn't matter what brought them together, whether it's good or whether it's bad, they are called a jama'ah. This is in the language. Are we all together, brothers? This is according to the Arabic language. Lakin, in the Sharia, what does jama'ah mean? In the Sharia, what does the word al-jama'ah mean? Al-Imam Abu Ishaq al-Shatibi, and I want you to write that name down, it's because it's very important that you do. Al-Imam Abu Ishaq al-Shatibi. Al-Imam Abu Ishaq al-Shatibi. The reason why I mention Abu Ishaq, because there's another imam whose name is called Abu al-Qasim al-Shatibi. Abu al-Qasim al-Shatibi is the imam of Qira'at, the Quranic recitation. That's Abu Qasim al-Shatibi. That's another imam. That's a what? Another imam. This imam is called Abu Ishaq al-Shatibi. So they're two different Shatibis. This is another Shatibi. He mentions that in the Sharia, the word al-jama'ah has five meanings. In his kitab al-i'tisam, he mentions this in his book al-i'tisam. Al-Imam Abu Ishaq al-Shatibi, when it comes to the word, let me repeat it slowly, okay? We've just spoken about the word jama'ah linguistically. What did we say? It's al-adad al-kathir. It's large number. True or false? We all agree? Do we all agree on that? Now I'm moving on to the shar'i definition. I said the shar'i definition, al-Imam Abu Ishaq al-Shatibi defined it. Are we all together? And where did he define it in? In his kitab al-i'tisam. In which book? Al-i'tisam. He gave five definitions. How many definitions did he give? Five different views. Five different statements from the scholars. He brought five of them. So you go to the kitab al-i'tisam and look at it, inshallah ta'ala. I'm going to summarize those five views for you. Into what? Into two only. All of those five, they go back to two views only. Number one, so shar'an, the word al-jama'ah means, number one, it is a jama'ah ammah. And the second one is jama'ah khasa. Pay attention here with me. Jama'ah ammah, it's the general type of jama'ah. General. And the second one is jama'a khasa, specific type of jama'a. Are we all together? What does the jama'a amma mean? The general jama'a. It means the people who have sound al-aqidah and manhaj. I'll explain those two inshallah ta'ala. Jama'a amma is the unity and the group who share one aqidah and one manhaj. They don't know each other. They live in different places around the world. One lives in Dubai, a group live in Dubai. Others live in, they've never met each other. But what brought them together and made them a jama'ah is what? Al-aqidah and manhaj. This is jama'ah amma. Are we all together? Does that make sense? Pay attention, this is very vital. What does the word al-aqidah mean? Aqidah means, we explained it before, it's the theory side of everything. What is it? The theory of everything. Al-Iman billahi wa malaikati wa kutubi wa rusulihi wa liyawmil akhir. This is aqidah. Manhaj is the application of aqidah. How do you apply your aqidah? Are we all together, brothers? This is theory, and this is what? Amali, it's application. Are we all together? That's the difference between the two. So they share the theory and the application. Wherever you find them, you meet them. They are all taking from the same source. They speak the same. They talk the same. They act the same. Because why? They are all taking it from one manba, safi, a pure source. Are we all together, brothers? This is jama'am. It's everybody who has the same mu'taqad and same manhaj. The second type is the imam of the Muslims. Imam al-Muslimin. And the people who are under the imam. This is a jama'ah. They are not allowed to go against it. They have a Muslim leader over them, who's governing them, who is there, and they are underneath that leader who they've given a pledge of allegiance. They are not allowed to deceive him, so they have to stay in that position. This is a jama'ah, which is khasa. وَلِذَلِكَ if you pay attention to the hadith of Hudhayfah ibn al-Yaman, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told Hudhayfah that there's going to come a time and the trials and tribulations that the Prophet mentioned to him. In that hadith, Hudhayfa said, فَإِذَا لَمْ يَكُنْ إِمَامٌ. What about if there's no imam that day? وَلَا جَمَاعَةٌ. There's no jama'ah. Scholars here like Al-Imam al-Nawi, Al-Imam ibn Hajar rahimahullah, ibn Battal, Al-Karmani, Al-Qastalani, and others, Shurrah of the books of this, and Mufhim, Abu al-Abbas al-Qurtubi, they all mention, if there is no jama'ah khasa, meaning you're not in a country under a leader, that country doesn't have no government, there's still a jama'ah ammah. You are with the people whose mu'taqad al-aqidah is sound, that's your jama'ah. Are we all together? If you don't find any of that, there's no imam and there's nobody whose mu'taqad is in your land, then the Prophet ﷺ said to him, وَلَوْ أَن تَعَضَّ بِأَسْرِ الشَّجَرَةِ حَتَّى يُدْرِكَكَ الْمَوْتُ وَأَنْتَ عَلَى ذَلِكَ. Don't make a group. Don't initiate a sect. Go away from all of that. And do what? وَلَوْ أَن تَعَضَّ بِأَسْرِ الشَّجَرَةِ. Hold on to the root of a tree until death comes to you, meaning some of the other riwayat mentioned, go to the livestock, go to the outskirts, stay away from the trials and the tribulations that are taking place. Are we all together? Ibn Jarir al-Tabari said, hold on to asli shajara here means The asal here means go back to the kitab and the sunnah and hold on to that and leave everything else. Leave the people's opinions. So one more time. Jama'a khasa means the Muslim leader and the people who are under that leader. Every country has their own country leader and they have their own issues. Lakin even then there's a jama'a which is amma between all of the Muslims who share the same aqeed and the same manhaj. This is what? Jama'a amma. This is the kalam of al-imam Abu Ishaq al-Shatibi, Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, al-imam Ibn Taymiyyah, Abu Qasim Hibatullah al-Lalakai, Qawam al-Sunnah Abu Qasim al-Taymiyyah. All of their aqwal, it's restricted to these two. Does that make sense? I summarize all of the views for you. So now we understand the term Ahlu Sunnati wal Jama'ah. Are we all together, brothers? So pay attention to this, brothers. Ad-da'awa ma lam tuqima bi bayyinatin abna'uha ad'iya. When a person says, I am Ahlu Sunnati wal Jama'ah, all of that which we mention has to be present in them. You can't say, I'm Ahlu Sunnah, and you reject the hadiths. And you give precedence to your own whims and desires. And you take the hadith when it fits you and it goes in line with what you like. And when you don't, you turn away from it. Are we all together, brothers? Ahlu Sunnah is a title, and it has under it a meaning and a reality. And so you have to come with that reality. You have to come with that. The second name that the people whose aqeedah is sound, they have, is that they are called as-salaf as-salih. So we're now going to get rid of this one. Has everyone understood this one before I move on? Does anyone have any questions regarding it first? This is clear, huh? Crystal clear. But they are called as-salaf as-salih. What does the word as-salaf and as-salih mean? The word as-salaf in the Arabic language, it means man taqaddama, anyone who precedes you. Anyone who goes before you is salaf. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, afallahu amma salaf. Salaf means anything that precedes, anything that goes forward before you. Salaf can mean two things. It can be zaman, which is time, and it can be a manhaj. Salaf in terms of timing, which is zamani. When the ulama, they say as-salafu as-salih, they don't mean time only. They're not looking at time. What are they looking at? Because if we say time, then who would fall under that? Abu Jahl, Abu Lahab, because they have preceded us in time. And did they live at the time of the Prophet? They did. But when we attribute ourselves, we're not attributing ourselves to them. Are we all together? We're attributing ourselves to a people who've preceded us in time, and they also preceded us in what? Together simultaneously. Does that make sense? Salaf means anyone who preceded you. The person is then called, it's called Salafi. This ya is the ya of ascription. In Arabic, what is it called? The ya of Kitabi, my book. So you're attributing to yourself and you're ascribing yourself, because it's the word salaf, sin, lam, fa. This ya means my salaf. So you're attributing the salaf to yourself, right? This is the ya of ascription, and the ya of attribution. Pay attention here now. If you're attributing yourself to them, you are not attributing yourself to those who preceded you in time. Because those who preceded you in time consist of evil people like Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab and Jahm ibn Safwan and the likes of these people. No. You're referring to a people who preceded you in what? In timing, and they also preceded you in what? And they preceded you in manhaj or mu'taqad, whichever one you want to call it. They preceded you in virtue. They preceded you in virtue and timing. Are we all together? Does that make sense? That is what, so the person is now called a what? The person calls himself Salafi. The question here is now, this time that you've mentioned, Abdul Rahman, are they restricted at a particular time? Is it a particular time or is it just unrestricted? It's restricted to the three noble generation. So the first one is Khayrun Nasi Qarni, the time of the Prophet ﷺ, Zamanun Nabi. The time of the Prophet ﷺ. And the second one is Tabi'een. And the third one is Tabi'u. And the third one is the Tabi'u Tabi'een. These are the three, based on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam statement, where the Prophet said, "Khayrun nasi qarni, thumma alladhina yalunahum, thumma alladhina yalunahum." So the Prophet mentioned how many generations? So you're saying, these three generations are called al-qurun. Al-Qurun al-Fadila, the noble generation, the golden generation. This is the golden generation. This is the most virtuous. But is it just time? Because in those time, who lived? Zaman al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who lived? Abu Jahl, I said it, Abu Lahab. Zaman al-Tabi'een, who lived? Evil people lived at the Zaman of the Tabi'een. And the Tabi'u Tabi'een, evil people lived at that time, sahih. So it's not just the time of those three, but it also is virtue. They preceded you in virtue and they preceded you in timing. Does that make sense? This is called Salaf al-Salih, the pious predecessors. We call ourselves, in order to attribute ourselves to that time, because the Prophet said, Khayrun nasi, the best of people. So if they're the best, we want to be with them. Are we all together? So the person calls himself, he uses that term, Salafi. So Salafi doesn't mean that there's a leader in charge who looks at people and says, where's your ID card? Show it to me. Okay, you can come in. You leave. It's not. It's any individual who follows the Prophet and his companions, and he also follows the Tabi'een, and he follows the Tabi'u Tabi'een. How? In belief and in action. What does he follow them in? Two things. I'tiqad, everything you believe. They believed it. You also follow them in what? Amal. Some people today's understanding of the Salaf is only Aqidah. They restricted the Salaf al-Salih to only I'tiqad. So they only believe them in Aqidah. But when you look at the manners and the way they deal and the way they talk and the way they carry themselves, and that's not how the Salaf were. Salaf had manners. Salaf carried themselves in a particular way. They acted in a particular way. Then amal, it has actions to it. The Salaf used to pray sunan and nawafil. They used to pray with the jama'atul muslim in the masjid. Never prayed at home. Salaf is big. It's not restricted only to aqidah. Are we all together, brothers? That's why they wrote books on Aqidah, and at the ending, what did they add to it? Manners. Aqidatul Wasatiyah. At the ending, it has manners in it. Are we all together? The Kitab Aqidatul Wasatiyah, which is an Aqidah book, at the ending, Ibn Taymiyyah adds to it what? Akhlaq and Adab. Because following the Salaf is in everything. So you follow them in their aqeedah and you follow them in the amal. Does that make sense? If you do that, you are a Salafi whether you call yourself or not. You don't have to call yourself it. It's not a must. But you are. Because you follow the Salaf in your aqeedah and you follow the Salaf in what? That's it. That's all that was needed and you came with it. You are a Salafi whether you know or not. You don't have to give yourself the name. You don't have to flag it around. That's all it is. وَلِذَٰلِكَ there are some who call themselves Salafi, but the Salaf is on a valley and they are on another valley. And there are those who don't call themselves Salafi, but they are. When we look at their aqeedah, when we look at their action, everything is in line with Al-Qurun Al-Mufaddala, the early generation. Does that make sense? So then changing the name doesn't really change the reality, sah? Are we all together? The Prophet ﷺ told us there's going to come a time a people are going to name khamar yusammunaha bighayr ismiha. They're going to call it other than its name. Sah? Riba is called what? Interest. When did it become interesting? When Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says, يَمْحَقُ اللَّهُ الرِّبَى وَيُرْبِي الصَّدَقَاتِ. A good name is being given to it, صح? So this doesn't change the reality of the fact that Allah is going to destroy riba. Does that make sense? So good name doesn't change something. So giving yourself a name doesn't make you something. What makes you something? The application. The living by it. That's what makes you a person of that belief. Does that make sense? We're now going to move on to... Na'am, fadal. Yeah? The ya' nisbi. Ya' nisbah is what it's called. The third name that they have, in which they are called, is that they are called Ahlul Hadith. The third name that they are called is Ahlul Hadith. They're called what? Ahlul Hadith. Again, as you can see, the term Hadith is being mentioned again, and not Quran, because the mawtin al-niza', the debate and the arguments, was never about Quran. What was it about in the early generation? Sunnah, Hadith. So Ahlul Sunnah, they're called Ahlul Hadith. What are they called? They are called Ahlul Hadith. What does the word Hadith mean? Lughatan, in the language, it's what? Diddul Qadim. It's the opposite of what? It's the opposite of old. Hadith is anything new. It's like Jadid. What does Hadith mean? Hadith is anything new in the language, in the Arabic language. It's the opposite of Al-Qadim, old. Al-Qadim is anything that's old. Hadith is anything that's new. It's like the word Jadid, Lughatan. But what does it mean, istilahan, technically? What does it mean? What does it istilahan mean? It means anything that's attributed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ma udhifa ila an-nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam min qawlin, the speech that's attributed to the Prophet, min qawlin aw fi'lin, taqrir aw taqririn aw sifa. These four, in which it's attributed to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is called a hadith. Any speech that's attributed to the Prophet, any speech, any action that's attributed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, consent. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his speech, his qawl is what? What he says? Anything that Prophet ﷺ, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ is what? That's a قول. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ is a what? It's a speech of the Prophet. That every action is what is intended from it. That's called a what? It's a speech of the Prophet. That's a hadith. The second one is a what? It's a fi'l. Fi'l is what? An action. Fi'l is a what? An action that's attributed to the Prophet ﷺ. Who could give me an example of a Prophet's action? Huh? Ha. The siwak. كان النبي صلى الله عليه يعجبه no. استاك النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. أما لولا أن أشق على أمتي لأمرت بالسواك عند كل صلاة. Siwak. The Prophet used to use the siwak. That's a fi'l. The salah that he used to pray and how he used to pray. Hajj. All of these are his actions. Are we all together, brothers? The second thing is, the third thing is taqreer. Taqreer means what was done in his time, alayhi salatu wasalam, in which he consented to. The reason why I didn't say in his presence, and I said in his time, is because that if that thing happened at his time, na'am, the Prophet did not see it, but who saw it? Allah. And Allah will tell the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, this action that the companions are practicing is wrong. So he will tell them, don't do it. If he doesn't say anything to them, what does that mean? That it's allowed. Are we all together? So anything that the Prophet saw the companions do or happened at his time and he did not object and say, stop this. He was quiet about it. This is permissible. Huh? There are many things that the companions used to practice that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala told them not to do. And there are things that they used to practice that the Prophet ﷺ knew they were practicing it. They practiced it at his time and he never objected. Like the hadith of Jabir radiallahu ta'ala anhu, where he said, "Kunna na'zil wal Qur'an yanzil." We used to do quarters interruption whilst the Quran was coming down. We used to prevent having children with our wives whilst the Quran used to come down. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never objected. Jabir is using the fact that the Prophet was quiet. Are we all together? And there were things that the companions used to practice and they used to do that the Sharia came, and that's the overwhelming majority of things. Sharia came and he stopped them from doing it. For instance, they used to say, connect Allah's mashia, Allah's will, with the Prophet's will. إِذَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ وَشَاءَ مُحَمَّدٍ, they said. What did he say when he saw them say that? He corrected them and he said, say, إِذَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ ثُمَّ شَاءَ مُحَمَّدٍ أَمَا إِذَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ. Are we all together? He corrected them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَلِذَلِكَ تَأْخِيرُ الْبَيَانِ فِي وَقْتِ الْحَاجَةِ. The messenger will never watch his companions do something wrong and be silent about it. He will never delay correcting them straight away. Are we all together, brothers? Does that make sense? Even if it happened in a place other than where he was, Allah will inform the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that this thing is wrong, they shouldn't do it. Are we all together? Because the revelation was coming down and Allah used to inform the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam what was happening. This is called a taqreer. Taqreer means consent. The Prophet just watches it and he lets them do it. This is called a taqreer and it shows permissibility. It's an approval. Na'am. It's an approval from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Lakin pay attention. The Prophet's action alone does not show obligation. Memorize this, okay? And learn this. The Messenger's mere action. Does everyone understand that? The mere action of the Messenger
فعله المجرد, just the Prophet doing something, it doesn't show obligation. It shows permissibility, but it doesn't show obligation. Are we all together? If the messenger does something, it doesn't show that it's obligatory to do it. Unless it what? Unless a speech goes with it. The speech of the messenger shows obligation. Are we all together? Obligation is taken from the speech, not from the Prophet's actions. Does that make sense? It doesn't make sense. Okay. When the Prophet ﷺ was praying the salah, what did he say to the companions first? He said, Sallu, Sallu kama ra'aytumuni. Sallu, pray. Isn't that the command? Now when he prays the salah, what do they have to do? What do they have to do? They have to follow him in the salah. But if he didn't say Sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli, and he just prayed, will that show obligation? No. Are we all together? Hajj, when he was going, what did he say to them? Khudu anni manasikakum. Take from me. Are we all together? Because the Prophet's actions, some of them are not shar'i. They're not legislations from Allah. What are they? They are his natural behavior. Sahih? They were his what? His natural behavior, the way Allah created him. Are we all together, brothers? But if he does something, it shows jawaz, permissibility. It doesn't show obligation, but it shows permissibility. Same with consent. If he consented to something, it shows permissibility. The fourth one is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's sifa. The Prophet's sifa are two types. Sifa means his characteristics. Ama, description. It's two types. Sifa khuluqiyah, which is his manners. Khuluqiyah, which is what? His manners and the way he carried himself. And the second type is what? Khilqiyah. Khilqiyah. Khilqiyah means what? The way Allah created him, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The way, and this is where you study in the book of what? Shama'il. Shama'il. Shama'il al-Muhammadiyah. By Imam Tirmidhi. Tirmidhi, what does he speak about? The way that the Prophet ﷺ looked. How tall he was. How his shoulders was. How his beard was. How his neck was. How his palms were. Are we all together? How his jaw was. This is how Allah created him. Khuluqiyya was his manners. How shy he was, alayhi salatu wasalam. Are we all together? All of these are called hadith. What are they called? All of that is, it's called a hadith. The hadith is categorized into two. Okay, now we've understood what hadith means, lughatan wa istilahan, linguistically, and we've understood it. This concept of hadith, the scholars, they categorize the knowledge of hadith into two. Ilmul hadithi, diraya, and the second one, which is ilmul hadithi riwaya. The scholars, they categorize the knowledge of hadith into how much? Into two. The first one is the knowledge of hadith in terms of diraya. What does diraya mean? It means the meaning in the hadith. Fiqhul hadith. The meaning that's taken from the hadith and the rulings that are taken from it. Are we all together, brothers? This is called ilmul hadithi diraya. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said in a hadith, إنما الأعمال بالنيات وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى فمن كانت هجرته إلى الله ورسوله فهجرته إلى الله ورسوله ومن كانت هجرته لدنيا يصيبها أو امرأة ينكحها فهجرته إلى ما هاجر إليه. What does the hadith mean? Are we all together? Going into this hadith and the meaning that's in this hadith
and extracting that out, that's called ilmu al-hadithi dirayatan. Knowledge of hadith in terms of the meaning that is in it. Does that make sense? Does everyone here understand that? Huh? The second one is ilmu al-hadithi riwayatan. Riwaya means the chain of how the hadith reached us. How did this hadith come to us? So that same hadith, innama al-a'malu bin-niyat, Bukhari narrated it. Who did Bukhari narrate it from? He narrated it from his teacher. He narrated it from his teacher, Abdullah ibn Zubayr, al-Humaydi, Abdullah ibn Zubayr, who narrated from Muhammad Ibrahim al-Taymi, who narrated from Ibrahim ibn al-Qamah, who narrated from Yahya al-Ansari, al-Qamah ibn Abi Waqas al-Laythi, Umar ibn al-Khattab. So the hadith is, Bukhari says, I heard this from my teacher whose name is what? Al-Humaydi Abdullah ibn Zubayr. Who heard it from who? Who heard it from Muhammad ibn Ibrahim al-Taymi. Who heard from Yahya ibn Sa'id al-Ansari. Who heard from Al-Qamah ibn Abi Waqas al-Laythi. Who heard from Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Who heard from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is now called the riwayah, the chain of this particular hadith. Does that make sense, brothers? This is ilmul hadith riwaya. Does that make sense? The scholars, they categorize that. This is where you study mustalah al hadith. This is where you study mustalah al hadith, the science of hadith, and etc. Does that make sense, everybody? Now, the scholars, they say, when we say ahlul hadith, what is it meant? What is meant by ahlul hadith? Does it just mean those people who have this ilm al-hadith riwayatan and ilm al-hadith dirayatan and no one else's? Is that what it means? The scholars, they said no. There are two levels of ahlul hadith. Ahlul hadith ala darajatayn. They are two levels. Ah, they are how many? They are two levels. The first level is those who gathered between the knowledge of diraya and riwaya. They have both. Or they have one of them, no problem. But they have ilm of ilm al-hadith. They have ilm of the science of hadith. Either dirayatan, they know it. And they also know it what? Riwayatan. They know the meaning of the hadith and they know the chain. Or they know the chain and they don't know the meaning. Or they know the meaning but they don't know the chain. Doesn't matter, they have knowledge lacking. And they also have plus amal. They implement it. They live by it. They live in their hearts, in their actions. When you see them, they are what? They are the people of hadith. وَلِذَلِكَ when you see them, everything about them, their movements, their gestures, the way they were, it's just they live by what the Prophet did. وَلِذَلِكَ شَيْخَ الْبَانِ was mentioned that some people, they went and they traveled to see him, to meet him. شَيْخَ الْبَانِ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. And when they went to visit him, they saw the ahadiths of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his day-to-day life. He would eat with three fingers. He would sit according to how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the companions would. He would act, he would move, he would talk, he would... Because he's living with these people through books. وَلِذَلِكَ the poet, when he say that وَإِن لَمْ يَصْحَبُوا, if they did not they were not companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and فَاسُهُمْ صَحِبُوا, their nafs lived with the Prophet. Every day they're in the room reading about the Prophet's life and what he did and how he acted in this particular situation and what he chose to say and how he chose to say it. This person, he finally becomes like the Prophet in their action and their doings. So they have ilm and they have amal. That's the first level. And the second one is al-ladina. الَّذِينَ يَتَبِعُونَ طَرِيقَهُمْ. Those who follow them in the path. They don't have the knowledge. But what are they doing? They're following the people of hadith. They are what? They're on the path of those people. This is the عَامَةُ nas. These are the general mass. They don't have the knowledge, but they have
correct, sound belief. They follow the people of hadith. They follow their understanding. They follow their way. This is called, this is the second level. Are we all together, brothers? And many virtues have been mentioned for them. Let's mention some of the virtues of the people of hadith, inshallah ta'ala, some of their virtues that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala gave them. When the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the hadith of iftiraq, you know, ستفترق أمتي على 73 فرقة كلها في النار إلا واحدة قالوا من هي يا رسول الله قال الجماعة أما قال من كان على مثل ما أنا عليه اليوم وأصحابي. الإمام أحمد بن حنبل. أبو يوتك هذا أما لا يزال طائفة من أمتي ظاهرين على الحق لا يضرهم من خذلهم ولا من خالفهم حتى يأتي أمر الله وهم على ذلك. الإمام أحمد رحمه الله, الإمام البخاري, ابن ماجة, علي بن المديني, أحمد بن السنان, and others, they said this hadith that said that's owned, there's going to be one group who are on the truth all the time. Imam Ahmad said, if it's not, so Imam Ahmad said this, Bukhari, Ibn Majah, Ahmad ibn Sinan, they said that if it's not Ahlul Hadith, the hadith is referring to, we don't know who else it could be. The Prophet said, لا يزال طائفة, there's going to be a group, ظاهرين على الحق, they are always apparent on the truth. They're always on the truth. لا يضرهم من خذلهم, the person who tries to harm them, it won't harm them. So pay attention with me on this hadith, because I feel like this hadith is very powerful. The Prophet ﷺ tells us here that there's a ta'ifa mansura. A group that's victorious, which we're going to mention, this is one of the names that they have. Like in ta'ifa mansura. And Imam Ahmad said, this saved group, this saved sect are who? Ahlul Hadith. Who also said this? Ibn Majah. Who also said this? Bukhari, Ahmad ibn Sinan. All of them, they said this is Ahlul Hadith. The saved group is Ahlul Hadith. Okay. The people who oppose them, the hadith mentioned to us, there's three people against them. How many people are against them? Look at the hadith. It mentions to you three types of people. لا يضرهم من خذلهم. خذلهم. So it mentions two people, sorry. That's in opposition to them. If you include them, it becomes three. لا يضرهم من خذلهم ولا من خالفهم. خالفهم. The people of hadith, those who oppose them are two types. طائفة المنصورة, the saved group, the people who oppose them are two types. Those who are deceptive. They are deceiving them by pretending to be with them, and whenever the opportunity comes, they pull out on them, or they mention their faults to others. The hadith says, لا يضرهم, it doesn't harm them, inshallah, because they have Allah. خذلهم is those who try to deceive them. ولا من خالفهم, and those who are outside in clear opposition to them. They're not deceiving them, they're clearly telling them, I'm not with you. Also, they cannot harm the people of hadith. لا يضرهم من خذلهم ولا من خالفهم, and the one who opposes them. So don't be from the ones who deceive the people of hadith, and do not be from those who oppose the people of hadith. Be from the group that's saved. Are we all together, brothers? The Prophet told us the groups are three now. How many groups are we going to have? A saved group. Second one is the mukhadhilin, those who want to deceive. And we have the mukhalifin, those who oppose. And you will always find those three are present, even in your business, your company that you have. You have the victorious one who are making it. There's the deceptive one in the middle, huh? And those who are opposing you, huh? The competitors, as they call it. Huh? Subhanallah, it's so true. So if you want, be from those ta'ifatul mansura. So this virtue is powerful. That Imam Ahmad and Ibn Majah and Bukhari and Ahmad ibn Sinan and others, they said that this hadith is referring to the people of hadith. It's referring to who? The people of hadith. Today, if you look at the hadith of the Prophet, the way that it's opposed is in the following. Number one, al-hawa, desires. There's a people going against the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ based on what? Hawa. أَفَرَأَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَهُ هَوَى. His desires. Second one is العقل. Let's rationalize this. تقديم العقل على النقل. Giving precedence to your rational mind over the textual evidence. It's another form of art. The third one is الذوق. This doesn't feel right. Huh? Have you heard all of these? الذوق. I have to feel it. Spiritual, I have to... All of this is مخالفة. It's terms, these are things that are used to oppose the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Ya ikhwa, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, Al-mu'minu kal-jabalil arif, yaqidu haythun qad. The believer is like a camel that's held from the nose. The hadith didn't say the neck. You know why the nose? Because if a rope is put on your neck, you can pull back. You can slightly refuse. But if a rope is put on your nose, the Prophet said, يَقِيدُ حَيْثٌ قَادْ. Wherever he's pushed to, wherever he's told to go, he'll go. If somebody puts a rope in your nose and pulls you, what will happen? You'll come fast. But if it's put on your neck, you might pull back. The Prophet said that the believer is like that. That when he's pulled, the nusus, the kitab and sunnah, when they pull you to a direction, straight away you run. Straight away you come forward. You all know the hadith of, or the situation of the khamar. The khamar was, if you read the Arab poetry and you read the Arabic literature, you will find out that the Arabs, they love alcohol. They drank it on another level. It meant a lot to them. There was not a table in which food was served except alcohol was on that table for them. Read the poetry of the Arabs, Imru Uqais and Antara and Shanfara, what they speak about. They always bring somewhere in their poetry alcohol. That shows you what it meant to them. So when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, and the khamar was bit-tadarruji, bit by bit it was banned. And we're going to speak about that in the tafsir, in usul al-tafsir. Look what they did. The first ayah that came down was, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْخَمْرِ وَالْمَيْسِرِ قُلْ فِيهِمَا إِثْمٌ كَبِيرٌ وَمَنَافِعُ لِلنَّاسِ وَإِثْمُهُمَا أَكْبَرُ مِنْ نَفْعِهِمَا. This ayah still didn't make it haram. It just said that there's a benefit in it and there's a harm, but the harm and is greater. It didn't stop them. Then one companion, he went and he prayed the salah and he read, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَا أَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ. He forgot the nafi, the negation. Instead of saying, we're not going to worship, he said, we're going to worship. Because he was drunk. So the ayah came down. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَقْرَبُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَأَنْتُمْ سُكَارَى حَتَّى تَعْلَمُوا مَا تَقُولُونَ. Do not come to the prayer unless you know what you're saying. But this still didn't ban them from the alcohol. So the sahabas, they said, Ya Rasulullah, Allah, please send down to us a direct answer regarding the khamar. And then what came down? The ayah of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, إِنَّمَا الْخَمْرُ وَالْمَيْسِرُ وَالْأَنصَابُ وَالْأَزْلَامُ رِجْسٌ مِّنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ. Stay away from it. When this definite answer came, this clear-cut order from Allah came, pay attention. There's a story Bukhari mentions in his Sahih. Anas ibn Malikin was at home. And as you all know, Anas ibn Malikin, his mother Umm Sulaym, she married Abu Talha al-Ansari, who she brought into Islam. Umm Sulaym brought Abu Talha al-Ansari, who's the stepfather of who? Amada and the what's it called? It's not a stepfather, it's called a stepfather, right? The stepfather of Anas ibn Malik. Anas ibn Malik was pouring alcohol for them, for his stepfather and for other companions. And then a caller called from somewhere far. So Abu Talha al-Ansari said to Anas, go and check, what is that caller saying? So he stood up to go and he said that the khamr was made haram. He came back and he said that the man is saying that an ayah came down saying that the khamr is haram. Brothers, wallahi, pay attention to this. When Abu Talha al-Ansari heard that, he said, Ya Anas, iksir al-jirar, break the glass and pour the alcohol on the earth.
Like the way they listened to the hadith, and they listened to the command of the messenger, break the glass and straightway pour this on the floor. And straightway Anas did it. Not one companion in that gathering said, let me just have one more sip. Let me look at this issue. Does it make sense? Where did it come from? Who said it? How did he say it? Why did he say it? The Sahabas never asked that question. Because Allah said in the Quran, إِنَّمَا كَانَ قَوْلَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. This is the speech of the believers. إِذَا دُعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ لِيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَهُمْ أَنْ يَقُولُوا سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. When they are called to Allah and His Messenger, the believers, they don't say, let me think. Does it make sense to me? How? Where? What? They don't say that. They say, Allah and His Messenger said that. I hear and I obey. ولذلك أبو داود narrated in his Sunan that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one day he was addressing his companions. And as he was addressing his companions, they were standing and he said to them, sit down. He said to all of them, sit down. As he was saying, sit down, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he was walking outside. He wasn't inside the masjid. He was outside. As soon as he heard the messenger's words, he didn't even wait to come into the masjid and sit down. He sat where he was, in the street. Outside where he was, he sat down and stayed there. Are we all together, brothers? And until we become a people like that, and we become a people who are like that, who follow the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in everything that we say and do, we will not taste the happiness and the joy that we're looking for. We're never going to receive it. It's from Allah tabaraka ta'ala's ways that the people he raises and he honors subhanahu wa ta'ala in this world and in the hereafter, they have to be like those companions I mentioned. Are we all together, brothers? When the Quraysh came to Abu Bakr and they said to him, look at what your friend claims today. Muhammad, you know what he said? He said, what did he say? They said to him, he claims that he went from Mecca to Baytul Maqdis, to the seven heavens, and then he came back all in one night. This is what your friend is saying, Muhammad. As soon as he heard that, he said, did he say that? He said, yeah, wallahi, that's what he said. He said, wallahi, if he said that, then wallahi, he did. Wallahi, he did. If he said that to you guys, then Muhammad went last night when we were all sleeping, and he went to Bayt al-Maqdis, and he went high above, and he came back down, and all of this happened in one night. Naham, I believe it. Why don't I believe him, he said. I believe him. He told me that revelation comes on me day and night. I believe that from him. This is nothing. And he earned the title of being called Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the people, when he was asked, أَيُّ النَّاسِ أَحَبُّ إِلَيْكَ, who do you love the most? Who means the most to you? And he said, Aisha. And he said, مِنَ الرِّجَالِ, from the men. And he said, أَبُوهَا, her father. Nabi Allah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, between Dhuhr and Asr, he used to sleep. This was his qaylula. He was known to do that. Except one day he chose not to. This was the night of the Hijrah. I mean, the day of the Hijrah, when he was told to leave. He went and he knocked on the door of Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr opened the door and said, Ya Rasul, it's Dhuhr. This time, he said, ah. He said, what is it that brought you out of your house? Made you walk to me at this time? He said, Allah commanded me to leave. And I want you to be my companion in the journey. And he took Abu Bakr with him to that journey. But ask yourself, what gave Abu Bakr that? Is because of his level of believing in the messenger and living by what the Prophet was like. And so that's what we need to work to. So we can earn this title of being from Ahlul Hadith, Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah, follow the Salaf Salih. Those, inshallah ta'ala, are going to be those are the most prominent names that are given to them. Inshallah ta'ala, we're now going to go into the tafsir class, inshallah ta'ala, the Usul al-Ulum al-Quran. Any question? Yeah? Which one? الَّذِينَ يَتَّبِعُونَ يَتَّبِعُونَ. Any other question? تفضل. the third generation. It's anyone who lived up to the fourth century. That's it. From the fourth onwards, no. The linguistic of what? Hadith. What is hadith linguistically? The hadith linguistically is ضدُّ القديم, the opposite of old. In other words, new. Inshallah ta'ala, tafadhal. The third one here. What is the third point that I mentioned here? Al-dhawq. Dhawq means senses. Any sensory. Whatever, like those who believe, who make their deen based on dreams or feeling. Al-dhawq. This feels right. Are you there? It feels right. I felt like I had to do this. Sah? The whole religion is based upon my gut feeling. This is dhawq. And this is something the Sufiya were the most at. This is what the Mu'tazila came with. And this is what all the tawa'if, everyone who went against the path of the Prophet, desires was always their base. Like in the Sufis, dhawq is what they base their deen on. Dhawq, taste and feeling, and spiritually it uplifted me. And The Mu'tazila, what did they base it on? Al-aql. Think smart, be smart. And we have that today. Afraqul Mu'tazila, till today. Those who reject the Quran and the Sunnah based on all what? It doesn't make sense. Logically, this doesn't make sense. Are you with me, brothers? So the evidence for them is what? Aql. So nothing new is what they bring. Everything was already dealt with before. So they only bring those doubts out that the Mu'tazila already brought. The modern liberalists and secularists that you're seeing today, they're just regurgitating and repeating what? That which the Mu'tazila already mentioned. Okay, inshallah ta'ala, we're now going to go into the Ulum al-Qur'an.